It cannot be like that.
So this one, we want to.
This one are directly cutting away.
This one won't get off.
Can we do full screen? You just have to start, right?
Yes, this has already started.
Okay.
Oh, hey.
So you can skip.
Shouldn't this occupy the whole screen? Yeah.
This will be a full screen for the ones who join online.
Oh, I see. Okay. Okay, good morning, and let me begin my talk here. So the title of the talk, as you can see, is Prompt Engineering of Large Language Models to Solve Quantitative Problems. So I would like to formally welcome you all. Again, maybe I am sure others have welcomed you already, but from my side, I would like to welcome you to IIT Guwahati, and I hope you will take the time to enjoy our campus also. So, okay, let me start with the lecture. So basically, the history of large language models, I'll tell you what large language models are. But it's better to start with the historical development. So the idea is that way back in 1967, there was a model that was called ELISA that was introduced, where the idea was, I think it was done in MIT. So the idea was that you could write a sentence and the software would respond with a corresponding sentence. So it was like a conversational engine. So that means that you write some sentence and it would respond as if it could sort of understand what you said. But the idea was that even though that was the intention, but you could easily make out that it really did not understand anything you're saying, because after a while, it used to say things which have no relation to what you had said earlier. So there was no train of thought. So it was just reacting to that particular sentence, and there was no logical cohesion. There was no coherence in what it was saying. So that was a very first attempt of creating a language model. So a language model is something that you can converse with, like you converse with your colleague or your friend or your relative. So it's like you speak and then they say something in response which makes sense, which is related to what you said, or which has some relation to what you have already told them maybe a few sentences earlier also. So ELISA was only the first attempt, and was very superficial, and people quickly lost interest in that. So the next breakthrough came much later in 1997 in the form of this long short-term memory, LSTM. So this allowed for a more extended conversation which kept coherence. That means that it could the sentences that it said like 10 sentences later was still related to what it said earlier. So there was some, it could maintain coherence over longer periods. So that was this LSTM. Then Stanford introduced their natural language processing system in 2010. And Google Brain was created in 2011. So this Google Brain did a lot of research in natural language processing. And in 2017, there was a big breakthrough in the form of a paper which is called transformer architecture. So there was a breakthrough in the form of transformer architecture. So there was a paper which was published called Attention is All You Need. So it So I'll just briefly mention what that paper is. I am no expert in this field, so I'll just briefly touch upon these issues the way I have understood them. Okay. So this transformer architecture then became the backbone of
you are correct. They have not provided details to this. This is under academy. You provide only after connectivity. So the switch power is low.
Yeah, I think it's desirable to have it. Okay, so let me continue. So just in the interest of, maintaining continuity with what I was saying earlier, I'll just backtrack a little bit. So the idea was that, like I said, that the whole idea of natural language processing and these language model started with ELISA, which was a very primitive conversational engine, and it was meant to just elicit some response with whether or not it was meaningful. But it was grammatically correct sentences which was outputted in response to some sentence prompt by the user. So the next breakthrough came much later in 1997 in the form of LSTM, which is an acronym for long short-term memories. And then Stanford created their core NLP system. And then in 2011, Google Brain Google started a company called Google Brain, a subsidiary of Google, which then led to a breakthrough in 2017 in the form of a transformer architecture. So there was a software architecture was developed where it could latch on to the natural language processing system, could latch on to some words and then infer the meaning of the rest of the sentence. So there were certain key words it could latch on. So the paper is called Attention is All You Need. So it was able to pay attention to certain words. I'll give you examples later on. So it was able to pay attention to certain words, and those words were instrumental in understanding the meaning of the entire sentence. Okay. That in turn later on led to the creation of these very powerful, massive language models like ChatGPT, which the ChatGPT-3 has 175 billion parameters. So I won't go into neural network. I think somebody else would have discussed that already. So you will know that there are these parameters that you have to tune. So there'll be so you have this biases and these weights. So you have to train these biases. So you have to adjust those biases and weights so that the output is what you expect it to be. So those parameters, the biases and weights, are 175 billion in number for ChatGPT-3, and I'm sure much higher for later models. Okay, so this is the example of the conversation that you would see if you used ELISA, right? So ELISA was deployed as a kind of a psychotherapist. So it just just to give an specific use case. So they try to deploy it as a psychotherapist. So you can see, I hope you can read what's written there. So so Eliza starts with her prompt. Is something troubling you? So the user says, men are all alike. So to which Eliza responds, what is the connection, do you suppose? So it gives an impression that it's actually conversing with you and it understood your sentence that men are all alike. But actually, you will see later on that this conversation loses its coherence very quickly, that it won't make any sense. So 10 sentences later, the sentences that come out have no relation to what was said 10 sentences earlier. So so that's the main drawback of this model. So you see it continues that way, that they're always bugging us about something or the other. And then it just gives out some generic responses. You see the sentences, outputted by Eliza are very generic. They are not very specific to the questions you are asking, right, as a user. So is something troubling you is one sentence. The second, what is the connection, do you suppose? So it doesn't talk about the specific psychological problem the user is having. So it gives a superficial impression that it is actually helping you, right? So, but anyway, so this was the state of the art in 1966, 67 already. So, which is impressive because if that's even before I was born. So, okay, so the next breakthrough came in the form of this paper, which enabled, I don't know much about this this particular topic, but basically this is about maintaining coherence over longer periods. So some other expert can explain in more detail, but the idea is that it was able to maintain coherence over longer conversational pieces, right? So that was the idea. So the important breakthrough which led to the creation of ChatGPT is called the transformer neural network architecture. So it's based on something called self-attention mechanism. So let us try to understand what this self-attention means, right? So the sentence says that this architecture aggregates information from surrounding words to determine the meaning of a given bit of language in context. So that means it actually looks for latches on to some particular word it thinks is important to understand the rest of the sentence. So it uses some statistical reasoning to figure out which word in that sentence is likely to be the key word which you have to latch on to in order to understand the rest of the sentence. So because of that, it's also parallelizable. So it can parallelly search all the different words in the sentence, so you can give selective importance to various words in the sentence parallelly. That means it doesn't have to do one by one, it can do simultaneously. So that's one of the main advantage of this transformer architecture. Let us look at this example. I arrived at the bank after crossing the, so if you take this phrase, I arrived at the bank after crossing the, so it depends on, so the meaning of the word bank will depend on what comes after the last word the. So the after the last word, if the word that comes is road, so I arrived at the bank after crossing the road, then the word bank means basically a building, right? So it means building, where some you can do financial transaction. That's what it means. So if the word is road, if the last word is road, then the word bank means a building where you can do financial transaction. But on the other hand, if the last word is river, so in other words, the sentence is, I arrived at the bank after crossing the river. So if that is your sentence, then clearly the word bank means something completely different, right? So what does the word bank mean in this case? It means the shore of a river. It's not a building anymore, right? So it means the shore of a river. So the so it depends on the context. So you can see that the word bank can have different meaning depending upon whether it is road or river. So what transformer architecture does is that it understands that it is this last word which has to be properly understood to understand the meaning of the sentence. So the meaning of the sentence will completely change if the last word is changed. So what transformer architecture does is it figures out which are these key words in that sentence, which are the likely key words in the sentence, and it latches on to that and gives more weightage to that, more importance, and then it figures out the meaning of the rest of the sentence that way. Okay. So so you can see that so the transformer only performs a small number of constant steps. It doesn't sequentially go from one word to the other. So it will use some statistical reasoning and a self-attention mechanism. So it directly models the relationship between words in a sentence regardless of their position. So in this example, I arrived at the bank after crossing the river. To determine the word bank refers to the shore of the river and not a financial institution, the transformer can learn to immediately attend to the word river, right? So it attends to the last word. So the title of the paper, attention, is all you need. So it pays attention to the last word, which is river, and then infers the meaning of the rest of the sentence, including the meaning of the word bank, whose meaning changes depending upon whether it is river or whether it is road. Okay, so that was the important breakthrough that led to the later creation of ChatGPT and its variants and successors. So let me go back and just give you an overview of large language models and generically what are large language models. So large language models are powerful artificial intelligence systems designed to understand, generate, and manipulate human language. So they not only understand human language. So this word understanding is a very loaded term. So we have to kind of justify that. When you say that some algorithm is understanding something, that's a very, very tall claim that you have to actually justify it. So we'll see how, in what sense it understands. Okay. So it understands to some extent, and we have to justify what that means. But it also generates, not only does it understand in a certain sense, it also generates language, right? So it's a generative AI. It generates its own output, which is also of the same type that the prompt is. And right, so that those are the main ideas of large language models. So they all rely on this transformer architecture, which uses the self-attention mechanism to figure out the keywords in a sentence, and then that will speed up its understanding of the rest of the sentence. So, and these are all many of them are pre-trained. That means they're so. In fact, ChatGPT. What is G means generative, P means pre-trained, right? And T means transformer. So ChatGPT means exactly that. It's a generative model, so it generates output, and it is pre-trained. That means it has been trained over many, in fact, it has trained over the entire internet. So all the information over the internet has been used to train ChatGPT-3 and its successors. So I'm sure even beyond internet also, I'm sure they have used actual books and other resources. So it is trained over a massive amount of information that's already out there. And it's based on this transformer architecture. And these large language models can generate coherent and contextually relevant texts, enabling tasks like language translation, text summarization, and content creation. So in other words, it can also translate from one language to another, which is very useful. So if you know a certain language and you want to know what it means in a different language, it can give you some hint about, like, it will of course miss all the nuance, like idioms and metaphors and all that are not properly captured, because a metaphor in one language may not have an equivalent in a different language. So it will literally translate the words, so that may not make much sense in a different language, but that is to be expected anyway. But it certainly enables literal translation quite easily. And it can also make out, you know, a certain, for example, if a sentence uses certain keywords which indicates you're angry, if you're angry, you'll write certain words in a sentence, which you would normally not write when you're not angry. So it can actually make out that you're angry by picking on those words, right? If you're happy, you'll use certain words. You're more likely to use certain words when you're happy, as opposed to when you're not, and that sort of thing. So that's called sentiment analysis. So it's able to do that, and it can also answer just like Eliza. Of course, that was very primitive, but the modern ones can actually answer questions in a very useful way. And I've been using it almost daily nowadays. Okay. So specifically coming to these GPT models released by OpenAI. So like I told you already, it has 175 billion parameters, right? So those weights and biases, there are 175 of them. And they excel in various natural language processing tasks. And they're quite impressive in not only reading, but also generating human-like text. So you will see that it can also do certain things like translation. I've tried. I'm going to display some. In fact, I want you to tell me whether that was accurate or not. But beyond translation, it can also generate poems, which I'm also going to display very soon. And it can very, very importantly and crucially generate code. That means it can write programs, which you can run on a different system, right? So it can actually write code in C, Python, Fortran, and whatever. It can write in Mathematica. My favorite programming language is Mathematica, because I'm a physics guy and I find that more useful. But it knows all these languages, even the Mathematica is not open source, right? So it's its proprietary language still understands Mathematica. So it knows Mathematica, it knows all the standard programming like C++, Python, Fortran, anything you name it, it knows everything. So you can write a English sentence and say, write a program to do this. Suppose you're new to programming, or you're just too lazy to write the program, and you just want, or you want a skeleton of the program to start with, then you can modify it according to your requirements. So maybe it doesn't do a really good job initially, but that's okay. It will give you some hints on how to structure the program. So you ask it in normal English, you say, I want to accomplish these tasks. Can you write a program in Python to do it? So it will actually write a program in Python and give you, and then it's up to you to, the way I usually do it, I just run the program and then I see if the output is meaningful. If it's meaningful, I'm already happy. Otherwise, I'll kind of see what went wrong And I actually go back to the language model and say that I've done that already. Let me explain that to you a little later. But the idea is that I go back to the language model and said, this was my error message. Can you improve your program? I've done that myself. So it actually creates a different program where those errors are now corrected in response to those error messages. So I have myself done that very successfully. So it's quite remarkable that it can actually do all that. And it's just a language model. All it does is understands language. But then you see, coding is a kind of language, right? Computer programs are like ideally suited for models because they are a form of language. Okay. Okay, so let us come to specific examples of what these language models can do. I mentioned translation. But translation into a non-English language is likely to be not so good. And I would request you to tell me if this makes any sense. Probably, very likely, it doesn't make any sense. I can't read the script. Am I saying this right? It's Dzongkha. Is that Bhutanese, right? So it's called Dzongkha, right? So does this sentence make any sense to you? This was generated by ChatGPT. I wanted to welcome our delegates from Bhutan to IIT Guwahati. So I translated that to Dzongkha. Does this make sense? Not likely, right? What does it say? You can't read. Okay. Can I enlarge this? Not likely. Yeah. No, it won't make any sense, right? Yeah, I apologize, but then that is to be expected, and it's only optimized for English. Okay, so far. Yeah. No, but this PPT will be available anyway. Okay, you can share. Yeah. All right. So, but let's get to some other examples where it's actually doing something useful. The next is I wrote a poem. I knew that was not going to work. So welcoming somebody in their native language, ChatGPT will not do it. But instead, if I ask you to write a poem, welcoming delegates from Bhutan to IIT Guwahati did a pretty good job. You can read this poem. So it says, in the tranquil realm where it actually rhymes also. I mean, in fact, it pays attention to rhymes. So in the tranquil realm where mountains rise, delegates from Bhutan's wise embark on paths of shared insight to IIT Guwahati, where knowledge takes flight. So it's good at rhyming, okay? So, but then you see these language models, unlike, you know, physics and maths, where there's only one right answer, generating a poem, there is no wrong answer. Every poem, so you can have a poem that you may like or you may dislike, but there's no such thing as a wrong poem. But there's always a wrong answer in a mathematics. If you ask a maths question, the answer is either right or wrong. So the reason why these language models are, when you ask it to do language questions, is because there's no wrong answer. So any answer looks right. And you can either be impressed by it, or you can say, well, this could be better. Then you try again. You might be more impressed. So that's the reason why it gives an impression that it's very powerful. But actually, it's only powerful in a situation where there is no wrong answer. Okay, and that is in language questions. Okay, so the conclusion is that these large language models are a significant leap in only natural language processing. So I haven't come to prompt engineering. Okay, and that's my next So I'm just describing these language models. So they are a significant development in natural language processing. So they actually understand language in the sense that, so in fact, I was listening to this lecture by the one of the founders of the main research scientist in ChatGPT, Ilya Sutskever. So I'm sure you have heard of his name. So he was mentioning that it is true that many of these models, they are like autocomplete. You must have used, say, if you use Microsoft email or something, even Google email, it does something called autocomplete. You try to you start typing an email, it guesses what the next word is, right? So it gives you a prompt, it gives you some choices that maybe this is your next word that you're going to type. So ChatGPT is like a very sophisticated type of autocomplete. You have a train of thought, it will just guess the next set of thoughts that, or say next set of ideas, next set of tokens. So the technical word they use is tokens. So the next set of tokens, it can guess. So it's a kind of autocomplete on steroids, basically. That's what ChatGPT is. But then the claim is, so what Ilya Sutskever was saying, that you cannot dismiss these natural language systems as merely autocomplete engines, that it's not merely autocomplete. So if you want to accurately say what comes next, you really have to understand. Suppose you're writing a long sentence and you want to accurately, somebody has to continue that train of thought. So if you want to accurately say what comes next, you really have to have some understanding of what came earlier. Otherwise, how can you accurately say? You can say something which is grammatically correct, but it may have no relation to what was said earlier, right? So what these systems do is that not only do they provide grammatically correct outputs, they also provide contextually correct outputs. That means that the outputs are actually consistent with what was said earlier, right? So in some sense, that is actually the definition of understanding. Because what is understanding is being able to, you know, continue a conversation which has some relation to what came earlier. So even though it is autocomplete in that sense, that it is simply guessing the right next word or next sentence, but it is doing that in such a close, you know, correlation with what came earlier, that you cannot simply dismiss it as autocomplete. So it is, in some sense, it embodies the notion of understanding. So the whole, the contextual completeness, doing the ability to complete conversations and maintaining the context means that it somehow embodies understanding. Okay, so in that sense, it is understanding. So many commentators have pointed out that now these language models, they are able to understand syntax. Syntax is just grammar, right? So just grammar, being able to write grammatically correct sentences. So not make mistakes. It's not like jumble a few words and put it together in a sequence. That's not a sentence. It has to have proper grammar. So it can do grammar, right? So it can do syntax. Then it can do semantics. Semantics, basically understanding the context. So it has to, so in other words, it embodies some kind of meaning. So it can do syntax, semantics, and more impressively, it can do something called pragmatics. So pragmatics is even beyond semantics. So I'll give you an example. Suppose you have this sentence that the shooter ran up to the victim and shot him. Full stop. So the next sentence is, then he ran away. So the second sentence is, then he ran away. So now when you say then he ran away, does that he refer to the shooter or the victim? Right? I mean, like, you know, if it could be both, right? Like, maybe the shooter missed the victim, or maybe like he was only grazed on the shoulder and the victim just ran away. It could be that. Or it could mean the shooter ran away after shooting the victim. So the question is, what is more likely, right? So that is what pragmatic means. Pragmatics means that what is more likely? The more likely is the shooter ran away because he wants to escape being caught, right? So it is a shooter who runs away. So that's called pragmatics. And then these language models can actually pick up on that also. So not only it understands the sentence, it knows that the word he in the second sentence actually most likely refers to the shooter, not the victim, right? So that's called pragmatics. So these large language models not only have mastered syntax and semantics, they have also mastered pragmatics, which is very impressive. Okay. Coming to the actual purpose of this talk, which is prompt engineering. So far, whatever I've discussed was about language, right? So like I told you, in language, there is no wrong answer, so which is why it can write poems. So you can never write a wrong poem. You can be unimpressed by the poem, but it's still, there's nothing wrong or right about a poem. But however, there's a in maths and physics and these quantitative engineering subjects, there is only one right technical question, right? You can have different methods of arriving at that right answer, yes, but then there is only one right answer. And unfortunately, these language models are very, very poor at answering technical questions because they are based on these autocomplete ideas, which is based on basically a statistical correlation argument. So that means they see if the next token is consistent or is statistically expected from the earlier tokens. So that may or may not be useful in answering technical questions correctly. So that depends upon how the models have been trained, whether they have been trained with sufficient technical questions as training examples or not. Very likely they have not been. So the idea is that you can't really directly use them to solve technical questions, because if you try, you will get completely wrong answers. So the whole idea of prompt engineering is to figure out a way of asking or prompting the system that it can possibly give you correct answers to quantitative questions also. Okay. So that's what that is. So that is the meaning of prompt engineering. So let me give you examples. So I wanted to answer this question. Right. So there is a relativistic. I don't know how many of you are from physics, and if you knew special relativity. So imagine there's a particle which is, relativistic. That means it moves so close to the speed of light, and you apply a force, and you want to know the speed of the particle after some time. So you apply a constant force. Right, so you want to know the speed of the particle after some time. Now, if you put in the numbers, right, you can do it yourself. You just integrate f times t, right, is mv over square root of 1 minus v squared by c squared is equal to f times t, and from there you can find. So I'll tell you the direct answer. If you ask directly that question by putting in the numbers, it gives you the wrong answer. I'll tell you the wrong answer later. So what I did was, I knew that it was going to give the wrong answer if you ask, because it's a numerical maths type of question, right? So it's a language model that's likely to give the wrong answer. So what I did instead was, instead of asking that direct question, I said, why don't you write a code? Because you see, language models are very, very good at writing code because code is a form of language. So I said, why don't you write a code to solve this problem? So I said, write code in Mathematica to find the speed. Mathematica is my favorite language. You could put Python or C there. It can do it equally well. Okay. So write code in Mathematica to find the speed of a relativistic particle starting from rest, acted on by a constant force. And then it really, I mean, it's quite impressive. All this was generated by as if it's reading from a textbook, right? I mean, I'm sure that if you search hard enough, these formulas will be there in some textbook. But it's not really easy to find in that kind of context. So it's able to, you know, put together all that different information. Because I can ask it any physics question, it will generate equally impressive steps. Like, so the idea is that in prompt engineering, if you want to answer technical questions, you should not just give some numerical values and say, tell me the numerical answer. You should ask it instead. First, you give me the steps by which you can get the answer. Don't give any numerical values initially. You just say what all steps I have to do to get the answer. Don't put any new, just say that alpha, A, B, C, X, and just put symbols. And then say that, look, what are these steps I have to follow to get this answer? First, it will tell you very nicely all those steps that it won't make a mistake, which is very amazing. Next, I'll give you another example, which is even more impressive. So this is already impressive. So it knows that the force equation in relativity is not mv d by dt of mass into speed. It's actually there's this gamma factor. Right, it's the relativistic dilation factor. So it tells you what all you have to do. All this green thing was generated by ChatGPT. I didn't write this. This whole sentence was everything was generated by ChatGPT. So it knows the correct procedure, right? So then it generated. So initially I said give me a procedure, it also gave the code. So it actually gives the code. It assumes some values for mass. If I had said assume some different values, it would, because I didn't say anything, it assumed all equal to one, which is also okay, right? So it assumed some initial values, and it also gives comments. See, it's such a like, it's as if it went to a proper, you know, software engineering course, as if it has sat in where it actually writes comments also along with the code. Sit in programming course, your instructor will always warn you, if you don't write comments in your program, I'll give you zero. So it knows all that. So it writes comments in all its programs. So it after every line, there's a comment, right? So it knows that a human is going to read the program. So it's writing all these things. So it initializes some values. I should have given speed of light. It's taken one. It's okay. The idea is that it's able to now say that you do the ND solve is the program, the function subroutine which you have to use to solve this differential equation. It knows all that because it knows Mathematica. And then it knows what is the command to plot also. So it generates the commands to plot. So all I had to do was just run this in my Mathematica ID window, and then this output came, which is the perfectly correct answer, right? So you see the speed of the particle will saturate to the speed of light. One is the speed of light. So initially, see, the particle is acted upon by a constant force. So the speed increases linearly with time initially. Right? Is constant means what? Speed is proportional to time. So initially it will increase linearly with time, but then it cannot increase indefinitely because it cannot cross the speed of light. So as it approaches the speed of light, it will saturate. So you can see all that is happening here. So once the particle approaches the speed of light, it will stop being linear. It will stop the correct answer, and So this is one way to trick the language models into answering a quantitative question. So don't ask it to solve some, just give me some number. You ask it to write a code. Just make it write the code for the general, the most general version of that problem, right? So you make it write a code for the most general version of the problem, and then you run the code. So in some sense, it is not satisfactory because, of course, you are relying on some other system later on to solve the problem fully. So the language model itself is not solving the problem fully, just giving you a lot of hints on how to do. So let us see if we can remedy that also to some extent. So I want to be able to solve the problem fully without writing the code, right? So, okay, so before I do that, suppose I ask it to generate, let us see what goes wrong if I try to solve this problem directly. That means without writing the code, I want to solve it directly. So what will happen is that it is quite amazing that it, you're not able to see because people who are watching online can see it. So this is the correct formula. So let me write on the board. So the correct, it knows the correct formula, and the correct formula is basically so here
So you can actually derive this. Let me so the idea is that there is M gamma V equals F. Okay. So but then if you integrate this, you will get M V, or gamma is 1 minus V squared by C squared, right? Is F times T. Now if you solve for V, what do you get? So you'll get square this, right? So it's going to be this. So this will become right. So it's going to be, the correct answer is V by C is this. So this is V. So this is your V. So this is your answer. And that is what that is.
So you can't see it, but that's what they have written.
Put C upstairs, and so this becomes C squared, and C comes there. So that's what that is. Okay.
So you can see that for small values of time, T is small, right? So this is dominating. So it is Ft by M, right? F by M is acceleration. T is small. So if the particle just accelerates uniformly, so if for small times, the speed is very small compared to speed of light. So this is not important compared to this. But then if T becomes very large, if that constant force is there for a long time, the particle is constantly, it's accelerating, right? Its speed is increasing linearly. So it will reach a speed of light, then it cannot cross the speed of light. So it cannot increase linearly. So what will happen is when T is very large, this becomes more important than this. And then you see it will cancel out and you'll get C. V becomes C. So V will never exceed C. So when T tends to infinity, V becomes C, right? So that's the whole idea. So it is able to know this much, that the formula is correct. Okay, so it starts with a correct formula, but where it goes wrong is when it tries to substitute the values. So it is substituting M equal to 1, F equal to 1. And then I said you put T equals 10 raised to 8. Seconds. So the correct answer is if you put T equals 10 raised to 8 seconds, and you put M equal to 1, C equal to 1, just for like that, you see right, which is corresponds to where I've converted this to meters per second. But bottom line, the correct answer is 9.4 into 10 raised to 7 meters per second. So the bottom line is that, you know, it actually, this is called hallucination. So that means it makes up some answer, which is it just. You know, just generate some plausible answer, you know, based on statistical reasoning. But that is not acceptable because this is a yes or no question. Either the answer is right or wrong. Yeah.
I'm going to your, since you are experimenting with
ChatGPT,
what is your observation about the repeatability of answers?
Yeah, I have observed. I think it probably is not attributable to you know, it documents. It is simply because it's hallucinating. So,
And this is a very dynamic one. A lot of information is getting added every day. So, if the ChatGPT answer itself, if I ask today one question, it generates one answer. If I ask the same question 15 days later, is the answer remains the same or it changes?
That depends on whether you are asking a mathematics type of question. See, if you ask a mathematics question, the answer is always wrong. Even if you ask 30 seconds later, it will give a different answer. See, that's because it is hallucinating, isn't it? That is, it. In fact, it's even worse than that. See, if you ask it a question, and the next prompt is that, are you sure? It will change the answer. I should have done this instead. And then even if it's the right answer, you can still kind of mislead it by asking, you know, this is the wrong answer, give me the right. Even if it's a right answer, you can say it is wrong, and it will correct its already right answer to a wrong answer. It does that, right? So because it's a language model, it really doesn't.
Yeah. People generate the answer in GPT. So I think there is also that there is a way to distinguish between the answer. It's a thing at the school level. Written by a human, and it's a synthetic answer generated by a GPT program. Yeah. So this will be very useful for our educator community.
Yeah.
Because I should be able to understand that, okay, this answer I'm getting is.
But assuming it is correct, isn't it? I mean, if it is a wrong answer anyway, you will be penalizing the student, but you don't want to reward a student for a right answer generated by ChatGPT, isn't it? Correct.
Now, your student generate the essay using ChatGPT.
Yeah, there were some claims that it's possible, but as far as I know, some recent interviews I listened to by ChatGPT.
Majority of the mails now in CCI. The homework answers for our student, you say that
massive hints
program,
right?
It can give you the right code for solving.
Correct, correct.
And tomorrow your student submits your business due date.
Yeah, so it's very hard. It's becoming increasingly hard to testing their abilities or the ability to use ChatGPT. So that may not be a bad idea, because after all, you know, like, see, we have become accustomed to using calculators. Nobody says, you know, write those tables to find square root of 2. I don't know how many of you know how to find square root of 2 using some tables. There used to be an ancient method to do that. Calculators. So ChatGPT is like is a kind of calculator. On different things now, you know, that so this becomes the baseline, because we know that they can do all this without any effort. So then we ask them, we test them on more creative things, right? So you ask them to do more creative activities, and which these automated systems cannot do, and yes.
People will not think when they know that I have a tool. If I just put my query, I'll get an answer.
Right. Yes. So as educators, we things. So we only start giving them credit once. So they have to therefore utilize these automated marks to use calculator, to know how to use the calculator, right? Use ChatGPT or any of those tools. There's no marks for that. And educators, we have to change our way of teaching. Okay, so this is the JEE Advanced question. So what does this question say? So imagine there are integers x and y such that the it obeys two inequalities. One is that it the points are inside some ellipse. So this is the equation of if this was equal to 1, it would be the boundary of an ellipse, right? With 8 and 20, square root of 8 and square root of 20 as the semi-major, semi-minor axis. So the points x and y, so these x and y are, by the way, integers. So they can be positive or negative integers, but they're integers. And they lie inside some ellipse. And then there is a further inequality that y squared has to be less than 5x. So you can make out that x, therefore, cannot be negative, because if x is negative, this will not be obeyed. So... So the idea is that as human beings, we can, with some effort, try to find out what are the values of possible values of x and y, because they are going to be only a finite number of x and y's, because they have to be inside an ellipse, and then on top of that, they have to be on the other side of some parabola, because y squared equals 5x is a parabola. Y squared less than 5x is on this side of the parabola. So it's inside the ellipse and this side of the parabola. So you just count how many points there are in that region. So as human beings, we can enumerate all those points. And then the question says that if you randomly select 3 points from that finite set, what are the chances that they will not be collinear? First, they're collinear, the area is 0. So you can randomly select 3 points from that set, you can make a triangle. Right, so in that triangle, so the triangle can have area 0 if they're all collinear. The area can be positive if the points lie above the if all the points have positive coordinates, then the area is positive. You can figure out that's why it's a tricky question. It's relatively easy to enumerate all the points in that region, but then that's not the end of the question. The question is, if you select 3 of those points and make a triangle, how many of those triangles will have positive area, right? So that is the question. So some triangles will have 0 area because 3 points will lie on a line, but then some will have negative area because they lie below the positive axis, so that the area is actually negative. And some will have positive because if all 3 points lie below the positive axis, then the area is negative. All 3 lie above the positive, then the area is positive. But then it's a possibility that one point lies below, 2 points lie above, in which case it's not easy. You have to actually work out case by case. I mean, you have to enumerate all the possibilities and work out. So that's why it's not an easy question. It's a very hard question. It's time consuming mostly. It's not hard in that sense, but it's just time consuming. And for a language model, it is really impossibly hard. It's almost impossibly hard question. It's hard enough for a human being already. So the question is, how do you persuade, or you can you use ChatGPT? How far can you push ChatGPT to answer this question to the best of its ability? So that is the question that I'm trying to ask. So the answer is the following. So I did not say answer this question, just typed the whole question and said, tell me the answer. No, that's not what I did. I said, give me a sequence of steps, right, that can potentially begin to answer this question. So how would I attack this problem? Give me a sequence of steps. So it was pretty good at doing that, right? So it first said, I'm sorry for the small font, because maybe I should have increased the font size, but it would have taken too many slides. So let me read it out for you. I'll share the PPT with you, so you can always look at it at leisure later on. So it says, it gave me seven major steps that I have to follow to solve that problem. So it says, first step, understand the constraints. So it said that you stare at these two inequalities and try to understand what that represents. So, I mean, it actually tells me just think for some time. It doesn't say what to think about. It actually says just stare at those inequalities. You might get some ideas. So step two, it says, determine the region that these two inequalities correspond to. So the first inequality is the interior of an ellipse. The second inequality is on one side of a parabola. So the intersection of those two is basically the feasible region. So that's the region where, region of interest, that's the allowed region. So it says, it is actually telling me that determine the feasible region. So it says, it knows that the first inequality represents an ellipse, right? So, and it says that in so many words. And it says the second inequality represents a parabola. And it also tells me further that find the intersection points of these two shapes to establish the feasible region in which these points exist. So it is giving me a lot of valuable hints. Maybe, of course, as a human being, I would have probably easily figured this out on my own, especially if I'm a student preparing for JEE. All this would come very quickly to me. But just remember that we are dealing with a language model, and the fact that it can actually think like a student who has prepared for JEE is quite remarkable. Okay, so it says visualize the region, sketch or plot the ellipse or and the parabola. So it, see, being a language model, it cannot draw shapes, or it cannot create audio or visual images, or it cannot do any of those things. It merely generates text. But then it is giving me an instruction that if you can do these other things, if you are able to generate sketches, or you should do that. That's what it's saying, that you should try and do that. It says sketch or plot the ellipse and the parabola to visualize the area, right, that satisfies both these inequalities. So this helps in understanding the valid points that can be chosen randomly, right? So it's giving me a whole lot of very useful steps. So these are obviously the correct sequence of steps that you also would think of. So this is how you would attack this problem as a human being also. And then fourth step, it says that if you want to further make inroads into this question, it says calculate the total number of points within the feasible region that satisfies both the inequalities. That is, you try to count how many points there might be, right? And then, it says how many ways can you select three distinct points from those set of points. So that is a combinatorial question, right? So if you have, say, 12 points, how many ways can you select three from 12, right? So you want a triangle, right? So you want to create a triangle, so you need 3 points. So it says figure out how many ways you can select three from however many points there are in that region. So so it's saying all that. And then it says that you divide the number of ways in which you can take 3 points. I actually slightly changed this question, by the way. The original question was find the number of ways in which you can create a triangle with positive area. That's much too hard for even a human being to answer, because it involves enumerating all possibilities and explicitly checking each one of them. So I instead simplified the question a little bit by saying that tell me which triangles have non-zero area. That is easier, because all you have to do is count the number of triangles with zero area and subtract it with the total number of triangles. Zero area means collinear. So in other words, you count how many ways you can select 3 points that are collinear. That's a much easier question. That's not the question asked in the JEE. But I simplified the question because I didn't want this exchange with ChatGPT to go on indefinitely. So this is prompt engineering, but it really requires a lot of human intervention. But then you see, this is the price you have to pay if you want to make a language model to solve a maths question, right? Because this is a language model, you're trying to solve a very, very hard, like a JEE Advanced, one of the hardest examinations in the world. And you're trying to solve that using a language model. So clearly, you have to pay a price. And the price you have to pay is that you have to be willing to, give a lot of, you have to be willing to create a conversation with the language engine that make it generate a sequence of steps, and then systematically, selectively, you just pick out the first step and separately ask the answer to that first step. So that's what I've done. So it gave me a whole bunch of steps. So step 5 says, this is the area. So it's remarkable, it knows that if you have these, if x1, x2, x3, y1, y2, y3 are the coordinates of those 3 points, the area of the triangle is correctly given by this. So it knows the correct formula for the area in terms of coordinates. So it doesn't hallucinate the formula. You see, that is one thing I have learned. This was a new revelation to me. I thought it actually hallucinates the formula also. That I thought it just spit out some garbage formula because it seems plausible, because it's just like poem. Poem cannot have a wrong answer. It can be either slightly better than slightly better or slightly worse. I thought it will say, well, this formula is wrong, but it's not that bad. I thought it will say like that. But no, it actually gives the correct formula. You see, in the earlier physics question also, the formula for the speed of the relativistic particle in terms of the force, it was actually correct. I mean, it was fully correct. I was quite impressed. And now you see that here, the area of the triangle in terms of the coordinate is fully correct. It's not hallucinating the formulas. But unfortunately, it will hallucinate numerical values. So that is where you have to watch out for. So you shouldn't trust it to solve numerical questions. So if you put in numbers, it's going to get it wrong. But at the level of formulas, it can get it right. So you just stick with that. So make it do symbolic type of question answers, right? So make it do it symbolically, and then you can, that is enough for you to then get sufficient hints for you to continue solving that problem fully later on. Okay, so then it gives me all the rest of the steps also, okay? So that's what it did. So now what I did was I picked out the first, so it gave me 7 steps, remember? So I picked up the first step. I separately asked that as a separate question, right? So that's prompt engineering. So as a prompt engineer, I have to engineer my prompts. I take each prompt and separately ask one by one. So I have to put in that effort. Otherwise, it's just a language model. It's quite remarkable. It's able to do at least this much. But so the effort I have to put in is that, so first I make it give a skeleton set of arguments that potentially can solve this problem. I take the first suggestion that ChatGPT has given me. Then in a separate window, I ask that as a separate question. So I said that, look, X and Y are integers and they are inside this ellipse. And tell me what are the possible values of X and Y. Okay, so it gives me the correct answer. Of course, this is a little bit of a misrepresentation. It sometimes gave me the wrong answer also. But so that is a challenge. So you see, when it gives this is a numerical answer. So the final output is a bunch of numbers. So I told you that when the output is a bunch of numbers, it will hallucinate. So in other words, it'll output some plausible sounding answers which are actually wrong. And here also, because the outputs are actual numbers, the output was actually initially wrong. So I had to re-ask the question, saying that, are you sure? Reanalyze the question. I didn't do anything else. I said, this is the wrong answer. Do it again. That's all I said. And the second attempt, it gave me the correct answer. So that is the challenge. See, so the idea is that we want to automate these prompting. So that right now I'm manually prompting. So the idea is that I want to automate this prompting process. So I want to find a generic set of prompts that can prevent this hallucination, right? So I wanted to find what are the generic set of prompts by which any numerical question can be correctly answered. Okay, so that is a challenge. So far that is an unsolved problem as far as I know, that there is no way we can find a generic set of prompts which are problem independent. So that means they're not dependent on the problem. So see, if it's a physics question, I can think of certain generic prompts. One prompt is that before giving out the answer, verify whether it is dimensionally correct, right? So that's one of the things we teach our students anyway. So check the dimensions. You know, if the final answer is a length, it should be in meters, whatever. So is it the dimensionally correct? So that's the first thing. Then the second thing is limiting cases. If you make some quantity zero, what is the answer? Do you expect the answer to be this, right? Limiting cases. So you turn off something, you turn on something, make something very large, something very small. Is this the answer you expect, right? So limiting cases, dimensional analysis, right? And what is the third thing? So you can think of these prompts. These are generic prompts, right? From which you can try to prevent or minimize the hallucination, right? So you can give these generic prompts, and then you can try and minimize hallucination. But in this particular prompting, because the output was numbers, it is hard to prevent hallucination. It gives wrong answers, but then you just have to point blank say it's wrong, and then you correct it. Okay. So I'll just finish off. So the idea is it continued that way, and I picked up different prompts and separately asked, and then finally it was able to correctly answer which are the number of how many ways the three points can be selected so that it is collinear. So I could figure out the simplified version of this question, the correct answer. Okay. I'll end with this last paper, which is basically this was published in Nature last week, which shows that language models has been used to actually solve an unsolved combinatorics problem. So there's an unsolved mathematics problem, which was solved using a language model. And this was published only last week. So it is interesting because of that. Okay. So things are happening. People are using language models to do very non-trivial things already. So I think we should explore this area a bit more. Okay, thank you. And sorry for overshooting the time. And thanks for paying attention. Yeah.